she might have been able to get to that. And it's like, you know, of course.
If our Sunday school teacher could whistle like he does to get our attention in church. Talk about preaching to the choir. All of you know Pat as well as I do, and possibly some even more. So what have I got to say? Last week I got a letter from Pat. And, before I mention that, I promised Dick that I, Dick.
What is it?
This is the greatest. May I come over and sit down and sort it out?
We'll start over again.
Number one, hey, thanks for coming on out. And it's going to be a grand time together. The people here have worked hard to put this together. You know, when we have these programs, which are really neat for a community our size, seats aren't just brought out. The different elements, such as pictures and magazines and so on and so forth, the screen, are all taken into consideration. And what is the best setup to best address everybody involved? And Dave Stratton and the gang here work very hard to not just, as I say, set things out, but set things up in a certain manner. And want to thank you so much for doing so. And as I promised Dave, I would mention that here is an item that is in the gift shop, and you can rent this by the week. And I'll tell you, when you see the fury of this, it's devastating. When you see rocks the size of cars thrown 30,000 feet into the air, just last night, can you imagine them when they land? And here's a lady who saw it all happen firsthand, and her husband was in the middle of it. It must have been some trying moments, but we'll hear about that shortly. So, should you want to rent this video, you can do so from the ladies in the gift shop area. About a week ago, I did get a letter from Pat, and she had attached a little note to the inside of it. Said, Richard, I hope your introduction of me will be a few sentences. Here are 11 pages. Now, you did tell me I had 3 1/4 hours to do this. 45 minutes. All right, at 3 o'clock I'll get started, or you'll get started. I would, with your permission, like to make this available to anybody who'd like to come up after the program. Look into it. It's amazing. It's years of dedication to educating from the youngest of children to adults. It's a listing of degrees she has garnered during the entire effort, from associate degrees to master's degrees and everything in between. It represents her being a teacher, a facilitator, an educator, a counselor. She's a published editor. She's a published writer, author. Excuse me. She's an editor. There's a book in the library or in the gift shop called Surprise, Surprise, A Walk Through a Faith Through a High-Tech Industry.
Excuse me.
Because of her editing ability, that book garnered a contract within a couple of hours of when it was received by the publishing firm. And if you take a moment to read her foreword in that book, believe me, it is so compelling that you can't leave a book down. A gifted skill that can only come from God. She has it. Okay, there's my very few lines, okay? So, without any further ado, Pat Williams, welcome home.
Home is where the heart is, so this is always going to be my home. And I want to reiterate the thanks to all of you for coming, because I'm here for a very special reason. And I think Robert Frost could express it very well, and he did so for me. I'd like to share just a few of his words. The woods are lovely, dark, and deep. But I have promises to keep and miles to go before I sleep. Before my husband passed away from Lou Gehrig's disease, or ALS, which he contracted because of his exposure to the gases, pyroclastic gases, dust and heat, 3 days in a helicopter, hanging from the skids of a helicopter and pulling a man off a log which was floating down the congested, muddy Toodle River, pulled him to safety. And that picture is at the end of the pictures there. You can take a look at it later. He just was so amazing to me. And so when we knew he had maybe a year or so left, and he knew exactly what was happening, because he was a flight surgeon. He was a family doctor. He was a flight surgeon. He knew what was happening. Never complained. Always kept his humor. And I said, you know, Robert, your story needs to be told. Oh, no, I didn't do anything anybody else wouldn't have done. Well, Robert, I beg to differ. I started interviewing him. I started writing about him. I did a lot of research. And I said, I'm going to make sure your story is known. I stayed on in Salem, just surrounded by the love and support of all of you and so many others, until my mother passed away. We actually moved here so I could be closer to my mother, who lives up in Michigan, but it was a decent drive from here. And after Mom passed away, by the way, Robert described her as the most gracious woman he had ever met. And they were both very good friends. I had children, grandchildren, and now I have, as of 4 days ago, 13 great-grandchildren. and that is wonderful. And I enjoy them all. I have them coming during the summers for a week of camp invention, and I get to know them one-on-one. But nobody's ever going to take your place in my heart. Please rest assured of that. Well,
you have my verse.
Once I got to Oregon, I knew there were several aviation museums there. And I looked around, there was the Evergreen Air and Space Museum, which houses the Spruce Goose and, you know, a lot of historic planes, and both military and non-military. And I talked to them. They were interested. I went to another, it was an aviation and car museum near Mount Hood. Nothing felt quite right. And then I came here 2 years ago, and they had just completed this marvelous facility. Just the Dale Schaefer, what a wonderful man, research library, and the Salem Historical Society Museum. I was, oh, this is the place. This is the place. So, during the last year, I've been packing up some of my writings and the newspaper articles, some articles of Bob. We have his first medical bag there. We have a picture of the three helicopters that were involved in the rescue, the three National Guard helicopters that were involved in the rescue, taken in front of Mount Rainier, which is another mountain that we are going to watch very carefully out there. So, in the all kinds of articles related to Bob. And I just, now I've kept my promise to him. So, okay. Let's just do a brief overview of this guy with a great sense of humor. Because when I look back on him, I am still filled with love and wonder and admiration. He's never been one to tout his accomplishments. Every time you try to compliment him, that isn't anything anybody else wouldn't do. And he has a whole list of medals and ribbons, and but there are a few that I'd just like to mention. When he did the rescue at Mount St. Helens with his crew, and there's an article there, he received the National Guard Valley Forge Cross, the 92nd ever awarded in this country. Now, you've all heard of the Medal of Honor, which is our country's highest military award. Well, the Valley Forge Cross is the National Guard's Medal of Honor. He also received two awards posthumously. One was he was nominated to be in the Aviators Hall of Honor at the Uvdar Hazy Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C. And so as you walk up that walk, you will see Colonel Robert E. Williams' name there. The other one was awarded about a year after he passed away by the Army Society of Flight Physicians, the Meritorious Award, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later on. He was such a great guy to be around. Just humor. Loved everybody. I think that's why he became a doctor in the first place. Even though he didn't want you to think about his medals, when you saw him in the Army dress blues, he was quite a sight. And he observed every detail. I mean, that he didn't miss anything. No wonder he was a crack marksman with a 30 carbine at the rifle range. He was more at home in his flight suit with his flight surgeon's wings and company patches. He received his wings in both Army and Air Force, as well as his Air Force physician's badge. He was never so happy as when he was taking care of pilots and their families. He was a husband who was a treasure beyond words. I just learned something from him new every day. If you want to know anything, if you wanted to know anything about airplanes or cars, anything, the engines, the design, the history, he was the one to go to. When he lived in Washington, and this was before we were married, he decided he wanted to build a dome house. Never had done that before, never had built a house before. He built a 6,800 square foot dome house on Lake Amelia just because he was interested and thought it might be fun. That was Bob. He was a voracious reader. To the end, he was a voracious reader. He would read history, aviation in particular, military history, and he would complete a volume in a day or two. I mean, he had a photographic memory. Now, that can be a wonderful thing. You can learn a lot of things. But if you're married to someone with a photographic memory, sometimes it's a little annoying. So. I think just to refresh our memories now, we're going to have about a 6-minute video that Dave, and again, thank you, Dave, thank you, Richard, thank you for the staff here, Elaine, and is it Ron?
Bruce.
Give me your name again, because we just met.
Shut the lights on.
Bruce.
Bruce. I missed that one, Bruce. Sorry about that. For all his recordings, the work these two men in particular have done is just amazing. So my heartfelt thanks.
Okay, I got to move this microphone. I hope you can hear this.
This is a 6-minute Mount St. Helens refresher.
Those of you who don't remember it, how many of you remember it? Still remember it?
35 years ago, right?
Yeah. 35 years ago.
Well, it was yesterday.
Yeah.
Does that say something, Janice?
Typical.
Hang on here. See if this works for us. I needed some assistance. Oh, I got to wait for my power to come back up. I'm sorry. Put me on pause, right? Designed this earlier, so it's going to come up, I know. There we go.
Takes a while.
We have faith.
I told you to play again. You see me pushing it there. Come on, buddy. Here we go.
best word to describe what happened in 1980 here at Mount St. Helens.
The northern slope of the mountain is buried in several feet of ash.
Supposed to say the end, but didn't.
Sorry.
Gives you an idea.
Yeah.
Now, at the time, Bob and I were not married. We had known each other in the community. I was there too. I was in Portland at an educational conference. And I showed up for my workshop that Sunday morning. And we were told, get in your cars and go home. The mountain has blown. Well, you could not cross the bridge at Portland. So I traveled all along the southern bank of the Columbia to Astoria, Oregon, which is the most northwest corner of Oregon. And I stopped for lunch there, but as I traveled from Portland to Astoria, I watched that explosion you're seeing. It was hard to comprehend. That ash went 17 miles into the air. And it was so unreal. I was trying to comprehend. I think it was a good thing I didn't know Bob was in that mix at the time. Let me show you some things here. These are the three National Guard helicopters, as I mentioned before. This is the man who was on the log. He was actually a Russian reporter that Bob pulled up from this log. Here he is treating him in the helicopter. And this picture, as the kids would say today, went viral. And it was on, it's in many of the videos, DVDs, and so forth. And so Bob was on the skid of the helicopter. Then there was a shock that threw him to the other side. But finally he got his bearings and pulled this man up while he was on the skids into the helicopter and was assisted by the rest of the crew there. So that's what that picture is about. By the way, living southwest of Portland, I'm only like less than 20 minutes drive into Portland, and I don't even have to go on a freeway. I only have to go a couple miles, and I see Mount St. Helens. So on every clear day, just about, I see Mount St. Helens. And I'm reminded of what this wonderful man that I was married to did. Well, how did we get to Salem? Well, we moved from Colorado, actually Canyon City, Colorado, which is about 40 miles west of Colorado Springs. And he was medical director of that brand new federal penitentiary in Florence, Colorado. And he had some famous patients there, like Tim McVeigh and John Gotti and the first World Trade Center bomber. But Bob knew I wanted to be closer to my mother. So there was this opening in Elkton, and we call it being a doc in the box. And they needed a medical director there. So away we went. Well, we first contacted that lady right there, Kathy Hendrick. She was so patient. She took us all over Mahoning County and Columbiana County. And we were living in a residence inn for almost 3 months. And she was just so patient with us because I was a little persnickety. Finally, she found us this home on Westfield Drive. But the reason we kept coming back to Salem, we decided, you know, we'd go maybe 40 miles south, 40 miles north. We kept coming back to Salem. We checked out the schools, the neighborhoods, and the education here, what kind of doctors were here, and the cultural facilities. And we just saw a community that was so involved in all these cultural areas. And the preservation and history of this town was just so obvious. And that was right. That was our cup of tea. So we decided one afternoon to go to Coons Airport. And Bob, being an aviator, and he has what I call the aviation gene. And that's something totally unique to aviators. Don't even try and understand it, okay? So we took a flight over in the Salem area. It was lovely, it was wonderful. And then we got out of the plane and went to pay our fee, and then Bob just stopped. And he saw this picture. Look, there's a flying flea. What do you mean a flying flea? What do you mean? So it actually was a picture of this uniquely designed small aircraft from the 1930s. And the person who was helping us said, I want to introduce you to somebody. You're the first person here who's ever recognized a flying flea. So we walked into a nearby hangar to meet Richard Tice, who was, incredibly, working on a flying flea. Well, these two aviators recognized the aviation gene in each other, and they had a long talk sharing adventures. Well, we get into this house and with our old English sheepdog, and by the way, Bob and I rescued five of them during our marriage. And lo and behold, there was a concert in the park. And so we went to go listen to that. And there was Richard and his beautiful wife Hopi and Richard's sister. And Jan, I don't think I had met you at that point. Jan Europe. I got to know wonderful Jan Europe because subsequently three grandkids took art from her. And then through Hopi and Richard, I got to know. I call her Miss Fabulous, by the way. So I invited them over for some cake and coffee, and as they say, the rest is history. They introduced us to so many of you people who were involved in the Historical Society, the Preservation Society, the Butler Institute. You just can't imagine all of these wonderful giving people, and you know it as you sit here. You know how you give to this community and how you make it vibrant despite what this country's gone through in the economic hardships. So, lo and behold, I find myself sitting on some boards and joining some clubs and just loving every minute of it. Well, we were here about 8 months, and Bob kept having shoulder problems, and so we went to Canton, and they thought it was a shoulder injury because he was in the first class of flight surgeons in the Army, and part of qualifying for that was he had to do a residency in San Antonio. He had to go down to Florida and, as a 50-year-old, trained with Navy, what would be probably Navy SEALs. It was Navy Survival School. Well, he hurt his shoulder. And then the third component of the flight surgeon's qualifications was he got his master's in public health at Harvard. Well, finally, we went to University of Ohio, and Dr. Mandel there, who was a world expert in Lou Gehrig's, diagnosed him within 5 hours. So we knew what we were facing, but we also gave thanks. If this has to happen, we are here with wonderful friends and people who have supported us. That was a blessing. That was a true blessing. I want to share a little bit about personal side of Bob and a little bit of his personal history. And I'm going to tell you a little bit of his work history before he was 18. And I think you'll be able to see how this shaped his character. From 5 to 9 years of age, he used to spend summers with Grandma and Grandpa Oglesby. But there was a little kind of tiny airport near there. So at 5 years of age, he volunteered to wash a Piper J3 Cub to get free rides. That did it. But he was such a hard worker. I mean, growing up in Payette, Idaho, his father was in a terrible train accident and had to be in a rehab situation for almost Bob's first 5 years of life. He says, I can remember my first conversation with my dad when I was 5. His mother was a cook at a local hotel. So money was very scarce. He went to work from 9 to 11 years old in the field, shaking potatoes and carrying sacks to the pickers. At 12 years of age, he worked in a prune and apple packing house, you know, doing just lots of chores there. And then one day a guy didn't show up for work and he figured out a way to increase his output. So he requested a raise and got it. It's pretty good at 12. From 13 to 16 years of age, he had 2 Ohio Daily Statesman paper routes, one in the morning. He'd get up at 5 a.m. and then one at 4:30 p.m. Service 60 customers. And he says between the ages of 16, he worked for one of the most intelligent men he'd ever known, Ursus Dalton, who was the mayor of Payette. He taught him how to do upholstery. He made 50 cents an hour. He hit him up for a raise when he found out that people at the cannery and creamery were making $1.15 to $1.25 an hour. Ursus said they weren't worth it. He did raise my pay to 90 cents an hour, but because of the skill that Bob had learned from this man, he was able to support himself, and at that time his first wife, who passed away from cancer. But he had 5 children at that point. He worked full-time, went to pharmacy school, and took care of this family. I couldn't have done that. So when he graduated, he still wanted to be in Payette. But he went back and tried to get more work from Ursus, but Ursus said, no. You know, you go out into the world and you find something to do And then if you explore that world, then if you're really sure, then I'll give you work. So that's his early work history. Let's pick it up where he was at 18 years of age, joining the Air Force. He joined the Air Force and went to basic training at Parks Air Force Base in California. And it was a school also in Amarillo, Texas. So he studied aircraft and engine mechanics. He was so good at it, he was kept on as an instructor, and lo and behold, he got a great deal for $272 on a Taylor Craft airplane. And after he went into the Air Force, that was when he actually did go into pharmacy school. About a year into after being a pharmacist, he decided he wanted to become a doctor. Okay. So he went to Kirksville College of Osteopathic Medicine. I think it's now Truman State University. And during this time, he purchased a 1972 Cessna Skyhawk. Once he completed his and received his degree, he found his way back into the Air Force, and he also served as the medical member of the crash investigation team for the Tactical Air Command in Washington, D.C. His highly recognized skills in solving crash causes continued in the Washington National Guard and the active army all over Europe, Fort Rucker, and finally where we settled in our first home in the Western Army Aviation site in Marana, Arizona. He logged in thousands of flight hours. Then later that year, the command sergeant major of the Washington National Guard enticed him to head up the 116th Armored Cavalry Attack Helicopter medical team. And that's what brought him to Mount St. Helens. You've heard that 57 people died that day. Over 130 people were trapped or isolated and rescued the first day. They went nonstop for 3 days and bringing out 300 people. I just would really like to end my remarks about this great guy with some remarks that were made when he was awarded the first posthumous Order of Merit from the it's the Aeromedical Order of Merit from the Army Flight Surgeons Association. It was delivered by Captain Dana Thomas. And by the way, at that presentation, Bob's younger son, Kyle Williams, Major Kyle Williams, had flown in from Afghanistan. Kyle was an amazing pilot. And it meant so much to have Kyle and his wife back there. But let's just end with these words about Bob. Colonel Williams demonstrated a love for aviation from childhood. In the early 1940s, as an Idaho farm boy, he washed Piper J3 Cubs, scheming for an occasional front seat ride. Always seeking greater access to the heavens, he joined the Air Force at age 18. He became an aircraft and engine mechanic. His natural ability and people skills led him straight to the Aviation Mechanics Schoolhouse, where he taught the remainder of his commitment. He then went on to pharmacy school and practiced for 2 years before going to medical school at Kirksville College of Osteopathic Medicine. He practiced medicine in Oregon and Washington states while serving in the Washington National Guard. During a routine training period with his attack helicopter battalion, Mount St. Helens erupted. He was the first and only flight surgeon with his team for the first 3 days, during which they rescued 300 people. The National Guard subsequently awarded then Major Robert Williams the Valley Forge Cross, only the 92nd ever given. This was in recognition of his personal bravery while voluntarily participating in the Mount St. Helens search and rescue mission. Major Williams risked his life by standing on the skids of a hovering helicopter to rescue a survivor floating at 40 miles per hour on a log down a river of molten lava and mud. Although hurled to the opposite side of the aircraft due to static electrical discharge on the first try, Dr. Williams persevered and completed the rescue before a 20-foot high mud flow roared through the entire river basin. His career continued with service as European Aerospace Medical Director while stationed in Germany, followed by the Aerospace Medicine Residency at Brooks Air Force Base in San Antonio, Director of the U.S. Army Aeromedical Activity at Fort Rucker, Alabama, and then as Chief of Aviation Medicine at the Western Army Aviation Training Site for the Arizona National Guard. His final tenure was as State Flight Surgeon in New Mexico for 3 years. Colonel Williams was diagnosed with Lou Gehrig's in 1999 and succumbed last January. Last December, his name was placed on the Aviator's Wall of Honor at the newly opened Ube Dharhasi National Air and Space Museum near Dulles Airport. She also, Captain Thomas, made a little footnote there. It is important to note that at a time when our country seems almost surprised that the reserve component, National Guardsmen, seem to be making more than their share of contributions to our overseas efforts, this year's winners have had exceptionally distinguished careers, both as active duty and National Guard service members. The Reserve and the National Guard's historic and current relentless dedication does not go unrecognized by those with whom they serve and share the burden of war and responsibility of peace. If you have any questions, I would be happy to entertain those right now. Anybody?
I think we're awestruck.
Yeah. He was always thought of himself as that Idaho farm boy.
Yeah.
There just was no pride in him. There was no pride. He was the Idaho farm boy, and he realized the gift of serving others. He loved people, he loved children. And it was just a joy to spend the years that I did with him. So I thank you for helping me keep that promise. Question, yeah?
If one thing occurs to me, you and he were our liaison, Tice Aviation liaison to the military. And they would, in our behalf, now they were a bunch of colonels, and a colonel is next to a general. By the time we were in business, all his colonel buddies were generals. Now he would call them on the phone in our behalf, and invariably, halfway through the conversation, the general would say, "By the way, Doc, I've had this pain down." He's got a bow. Have you tried this?
Thank you, Richard, for reminding me of that. The eyesight skipped that paragraph, but what a joy it was to work with Tice Aviation, I would do the typing. And Bob and Richard would talk for hours and hours, and that really was a great source of joy for Bob to be able to do that even in his weakened condition.
Do you remember when we had those typing sessions, sometimes I was so tired I would lay on the floor.
Yes.
And that darn big dog of yours, I love to come over and sit on it. Harvey.
And I took Harvey with me to Oregon, and I lost him a couple of years ago. But, Bob would say, Harvey would be mulling around and say, Harvey, sit down. Well, his favorite place to sit was on Richard.
But the young lady there in front had a question. She'd rather in the front seat.
She's right.
Yeah.
Did you have a question?
As far as the eruption went, how far in advance did they know that something was going to happen?
Not very far at all. Not very far. I think the labs which were up near Seattle, had a pretty good idea, but it was still very unpredictable. And to have this largest eruption in over 100 years was nothing anybody anticipated. I mean, we wouldn't have had, like the conference I was at, we wouldn't have had it had there been that, you know, imminent danger. And yet that's exactly what it turned out to be.
If the animals knew it.
If the animals knew it. Arlene?
On that, you mentioned, you just alluded to Mount Rainier. And that you're watching it now. Is there a danger?
Yes.
Because it's the most I had never seen Mount St. Helens, but I flew into Seattle. That's one of the most beautiful mountains I've ever seen.
It is. That's it.
And boy, I'd hate to have other people not be able to see it. It's gorgeous.
It is amazing. And before I met Bob, I worked on Bainbridge Island, which is between Seattle and Kitsap County to the west. And in the little town that I lived in, on a clear day, it seemed like it was maybe a block away. I call it the big dish of ice cream because it looks like a big dish of ice cream, vanilla. But that whole Cascade chain we need to watch it. And the wonderful thing about Mount St. Helens is that it really started a great push in the study of volcanology. And so Mount St. Helens is still very capable of exploding. And I think in 2004 it did again. But the whole Cascade chain needs to be watched. The West Coast. And so we watch. We watch. Now, the first thing I did when I went to move to Oregon is I went up to Mount St. Helens. And there are actually three centers and ranger stations. The highest one is called Johnson's Ridge. And when Bob flew over Johnson's Ridge, he took some pictures. Pictures that have never been published there. And I have given those to the museum here. So for those of you who, you know, are interested in more detailed study, you can see what it looked like to be in a helicopter flying just over Johnson's Ridge. And that those centers are well worth the visit. I mean, it's just, it leaves you breathless because the highest one, they have one wall, which is just a window. And then on a clear day, they will open these curtains, and there it is. Mount St. Helens is also unique to this day because it's the only mountain with a growing glacier inside. And it's expanding rather rapidly. So, yes, David.
With
When you went back to Mount St. Helens when you arrived back in Oregon, how much greenery is there? Has it grown back some green?
Lots of growth has come back. But there are still areas that just have ash. But much growth has come back. Wildlife has returned. In those early years, you could see elk that were burned on one side and then had their fur on the other side. But a lot has come back. It actually turned out to be a boon for farmers in eastern Washington because the ash is so good for growing crops. It's a fascinating experience. Anybody else? Thank you so much for helping me keep my promise to Robert. I love you all. Thank you.
Thank you. Elaine, prepare a few refreshments. You can stay and visit for a while yet and get some more closer information from Pat. Enjoy your presence with us today. Thank you.
I'm going to go to the house.